on the residential visit to Kenya paid by the head of state, President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi, and the consequences and the successes resulted from this visit. And also we're going to talk about the latest limited cabinet reshuffle that was taken earlier this week. The change of 9 ministers, 5 governors, among them for the first time in Egypt, the first female governor, one of the successes by the Egyptian administration. And we're going to take a comprehensive look on those, over those two most important events taking place. And we're very delighted to have with us Dr. Amra Hamid. He's professor of economics. Good morning, Dr. Hamid.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dr. Hamid, and thank you for joining us. And of course, President Sisi paid a one-day visit yesterday that was concluded yesterday to Kenya, where he met with Kenyan President Uhuru Kenyatta. And they discussed means of boosting bilateral relations and specifically in the fields of economics and trade relations, in addition also to combating terrorism in the African region. How do you see the significance of this visit and the main topics discussed?
Kenya is one of the most important African country, especially in Eastern Africa. And it's also, it has direct borders with Ethiopia. And as you know, now Ethiopia is becoming for Egypt a pivotal country simply because of the Renaissance Dam and all the stories revolving around the Renaissance Dam and its effect on the supply of the Nile water to Egypt. So what our government is trying to do is to establish solid relationships, especially with the countries that are surrounding Ethiopia. Kenya has also borders with Sudan from the other side, and it also has borders with Somalia. So it also has an important role in the Horn of Africa.
Mm-hmm. Right. Of course, Egyptian-African economic ties and the importance of those ties at this particular stage. Of course, we understand that for the past 30 years or so, there has been negligence over some parts in Africa, and especially the South Africa and the Nile Basin countries. Mm-hmm. Relations were strangled a little bit. So other countries flocked in the economic scene, such as Israel, such as Italy, and other countries dominated the economic scene in South Africa. So going back strongly into the African scene and establishing those economic ties and political ties at the same time with the good foreign relations, how important to effect that at that particular time?
Okay, as you already said in your introduction, I am an economist by profession. And economics is more reserved science vis-a-vis politics, political science, or other disciplines where you can always have speak about visions or dreams, if I may say, that come in the future. So from an economic standpoint, you are correct when you said that during the Mubarak era, 30 years, we have so much neglected our relationships with all the African countries. Although at one point in time before the Mubarak regime, and I have survived before the Mubarak regime, Egypt was always regarded by the African countries as the most important country in Africa. And maybe I said it before in one of the interviews. I remember very well when I was a university student, I was a bit sportive at that time. So we used to play these university competitions, and through these competitions we used to interact especially with Al-Azhar University. Al-Azhar University at that time, they had a lot of African students, and interacting with them, they used to tell us how important, they used to look at the African students, all the African students, they used to look at Egypt as the world looked at America. To them, to the Africans, Egypt was America of Africa. Of course, after what happened, because you may recall that what dropped the relationship between Egypt and Africa was the incident that happened to Mubarak when he visited Ethiopia.
The assassination attempt?
Exactly, the assassination attempt. And since then, for a reason or another, he decided to close all relationships with all Africa. And this was...
So Africa was neglected for a
30 years.
30 years,
that's very true. Mm-hmm. What happened afterwards is that mm-hmm. with the new regime after Mubarak, mm-hmm. or more precisely, because let's forget about the year of the brothers, the brotherhood, because this was a year of turbulences. And we can say that even starting from the transitional era of President Adli Mansour, up till now, we're trying to re-establish the position of Egypt, our relationships mm-hmm. with Africa.
Right.
From an economic standpoint, and without any offense, what we are doing so far is a lot of visits, a lot of shaking hands, a lot of smiles, but up till now, from an economic standpoint,
no tangible results.
Thank you very much. Up till now, if let's speak about the flow of funds, for instance. Is there any flow of funds going from Egypt to Africa, or is there, or vice versa? Are there any common projects that we already started? I know of very few ones, but they are, as you correctly said, nothing tangible so far. It's time to really realize the economic fruits of what we have started now for how many years, let's say from, to be realistic, forget about 11, 12, from the year 13 or 14 up till now. Let's translate what we have started on the political scene into something that we can touch, something really long-term, investments. And what by investments, I mean direct investments.
Mm-hmm. Right, sir. And back home, and moving on to the cabinet reshuffle that just took place here in Egypt, and of course the merging of some of the ministries together, which was one of the major features of this cabinet reshuffle, the merging of the Ministry of Cooperation, International Cooperation, with the Ministry of Investment. How do you see the significance of this merging of the two ministries on the and its effect on the performance of these two ministries?
Do you want me to give you my feedback about the reshuffling in general, or specifically about the Ministry of Investment?
In general and in specific about these two ministries.
In general, again, as an economist, I have to be conservative. I mean, things might look promising, but let's wait and see. Because actually, the star of the whole reshuffling, from my standpoint, and no biases to economics, by the way, it's only based on past experience. I think that the most promising position so far is the position of the Ministry of Planning, which has been occupied by the Dean of Faculty of Economics. Mm-hmm. Her background and her performance and her professional history is very promising. And from my standpoint, without any biases, I think she's the star of the reshuffling, and I'll tell you why. Though she's been an academician all her life, and that's a plus, that's a pro and a con, because and I think that the reason of her selection for this ministerial position is that she was very daring in one of her recent speeches in front of President Sisi, when she said that the only solution, she said it in public, the only solution for Egypt is production and exports. Mm-hmm. And I believe 100% that we don't have a way out without production and exports. So if she can incorporate, and by the way, she's not only responsible for planning, she's Minister of Planning and administrative affairs or administrative concerns. Mm-hmm. And this is another issue which is very important, by the way. So we shouldn't only look at the portfolio of planning and administrative affairs as well. If she can incorporate in her plan, which she promised yesterday to present to the parliament by the end of March, which is not very far, by the way. When I said when I read end of March, I was a bit surprised. Mm. How can she be able to finish this by the end of March? But anyway, the idea is how can she incorporate in her planning for the whole macroeconomic planning for Egypt these two very important factors, mm-hmm. production, and when I say production, by the way, I mean human resource, because production means people have to work, and that's a problem in Egypt, we all know that. So production in the first place and exports in the second place. So this is the most important, from my point of view, this is the most important ministerial portfolio. Going back to your question about the second ministry, which was
the merger of
the Ministry of
International Cooperation,
International Cooperation and Investment. Frankly speaking, from an economic standpoint, everybody is saying that she was very successful in bringing to Egypt a lot of funds. But the question is, at what cost? Yes, it's very true, but it was all borrowings. Mm-hmm. What she did so far was all borrowings and at high interest rates, which means that we have to pay them back one day. So, is this a success or a question mark? It will remain for us to analyze when we see what she's going to do with the new
investment.
Thank you very much.
Investment file.
Because investment mm-hmm. has two means of investments, again from an economic standpoint. Mm-hmm. And I would refer here to a very interesting TV speech by one of the economic experts, Egyptian economic experts, was only a few days ago. Mr. Hani Tawfiq, when he spoke about hot money coming into Egypt. Mm-hmm. So, what I expect from the new minister, I don't want any more hot money, please. What we want is for FDI, foreign direct investments. That's what we are looking for. So, if she succeeds in getting foreign direct investments, then chapeau to her. So, let's wait and see. As far as the rest of the ministerial positions, the changes, we have two or three actually, Mr. El-Sharif, Mselhi, and a third name, we know them. I mean, they are professional in IT, all of them, professional in IT with a military background. So, I mean, their portfolio is crystal clear.
Right. I was going to talk about Governor...
Before we leave, please. It's again, we have to mention also that we still have a challenge with the Minister of Agriculture.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm. We can put that file on the side, Minister of Agriculture, until... new statements could be unfolded. But let's talk about the realistic, I mean, there are some tangible, realistic successes on the ground, which is the female governor. But before I ask about the female governor, you raised a very important point. Mr. Hani Tawfiq, the financial expert, he talked about the hot money. And in particular, he was talking also, and he gave a comprehensive explanation about the flowing down or the going down of the dollar.
Yeah.
If you would like, as an economist, to give us an explanation or deliver this one, is it to the best interest of our economy? Piece of good news that we heard about the rise of the Egyptian pound to the dollar or...
Let me pass the question to you. Are you happy that the Egyptian pound is going up vis-a-vis the dollar?
I could be happy as someone who's not a specialist in economy. Of course, I do feel happy.
And the whole and all the papers, all the media in Egypt are also reflecting that we
optimism.
Have. Yeah, exactly.
And the Egyptian pound. Sign.
Actually, you can
Should
see
we?
Some comic, you know, drawings with the Egyptian pound, you know, beating the dollar and things like that.
Yes, and that's what we feel.
Okay.
And will it remain like this? I mean, or there will be
Yeah.
Well, Something different. I mean, will it rise again?
Okay.
Just tell us it's true, please, doctor.
Because I mean, I said it long ago on TV, but maybe in the French broadcasting service, I said it before. What is going to happen? And I 100% agree. Actually, I'm maybe the only one who agrees with Mr. Hani Tawfiq that first of all, in economics we should put the feelings aside. Because economics is a very realistic, down-to-earth science. So, feelings aside, as he said, and I said it also in more than one public interviews. No, I didn't say it. It's not a question of optimistic or not. It doesn't make a difference. Mm. When a currency goes down or goes up, it doesn't make a difference. We should not be happy. And we are not going into war against the dollar. This is the impression. I mean, sometimes I meet people in the street, very humble people in the street, and they say, okay, now the Egyptian pound is getting stronger, as if we're going into war with the dollar. I mean, even if we're going to war with the dollar does not even feel that we're going to war with him.
He doesn't care.
So the idea, and then a very important question. I mean, let's be realistic. And I'm going to come here. I did not forget your question about where we're going. The dollar, how much is the Egyptian economy vis-a-vis the world economy? How much is the effect of the, how much is Egypt as an economy compared to the whole world? What do you think?
Just give me. We are rising up.
Yeah, but what's the percentage?
We have taken a leap.
What's the percentage?
It could be, it could come to a hike in the next 10 years.
Can you imagine? Well, the next 10 years is a vision of the future, and we can speak about this, but it's a long story. Egyptian economy, and this is, you can quote me for this from a statistical standpoint, does not represent maybe 0.5, sorry, 0.5%, or 0.6 from the world economy, not more than this. So let's stop. It's time now to stop thinking that we're going into war with everything. We're going to war against Daesh, which is okay, against the Brotherhood, against Israel, of course, against Turkey, against the dollar. It's too much. The conspiracy theory is getting too much. It's time now that we start teaching the people, I mean the humble people, the humble Egyptians who are not educated, that we are not, the world is not fighting us. Easy. Yeah, it's time to reconcile. I mean, first of all, we have to reconcile, compromise
with
ourselves. Thank you very much, first. And then try to get rid of this conspiracy theory, because the people in the streets now, they are fighting with each other because every day in the morning, what do we speak about? The first thing, I mean, people who don't even carry dollars in their pockets, every day they wake up in the morning, how is the dollar doing today? Well, we don't even deal in dollars. Where is it going? What happened to the dollar going down from, going up from about 13% the day of the eve of the floating, up till 20 was expected, and I said it in public, that it's going to reach 20.
Okay,
and going down, and I said it in public, from 20 up to about 14.5, 15, which now today is what we're speaking about, we're breaking the 16, right?
Yes.
I mean going down.
We are. Mm-hmm.
So, because this is what we call the triple P, or the purchasing power parity, which is the equitable value of the Egyptian pound.
So was it expected to go
down?
It's
expected. It's all expected. And that's what.
And will it go down
further? It should go up to about 14.5. This is the equitable price of the. It should go down to. This is the purchasing power parity, which is it's an economic theory.
If you can excuse me here, Naveen, we still need to understand, what does that mean? Is it real or no? Because Mr. Hani Tawfiq said that that's not real.
What's
is it really
going down? You mean?
What is the indication for?
No. Well, the hot money is a separate issue. The hot money is a separate issue. The hot money has to do maybe
because
with
people were injecting currency inside the market.
That's a different story. We're mixing issue here. So the price of the dollar vis-a-vis the Egyptian pound is an issue. And as I said, to answer your question, it should go to about 14, 14.5.
And stay stable.
More or less, yeah. Because of the purchasing
so it went,
power.
It's going to go down to its real value.
Yeah, this should be the I wouldn't call it real, I would call it equitable.
Equitable.
Yeah, it's the equitable. It's about 14.5. And these research, by the way, they are not done by me. They've been done by academicians, by international organizations long ago before the floating.
So you expect it to go down to 14.5 and remain stabilized?
It should be. It should be more or less, yeah. Whatever happens, it should stabilize for a while. Whatever happens afterwards depends on our strength in producing, working, producing and exporting. Then we can even...
But sir, I would like just to stop here at the issue of producing.
Yeah.
What are the obstacles hindering us from production so far?
This is a long story. It has to do with the system itself of controlling the country. Because the people... I mean, the Egyptians, if you travel now to Upper Egypt, where I go a lot, they are not working. They don't feel, that this is what we were speaking about, the people are not feel, they don't feel secured. You have to create security for the people, for the Egyptians. When you create security for the majority of the Egyptians, I'm not speaking about Cairo and Alexandria, though it does exist, and at the same time create feeling of security and satisfaction to the local investors, then you will have a sense of security overall. Then you can even get convince foreigners to come and physically invest in Egypt and again, not hot money, but FDI, foreign direct investment.
What about local investment? I mean, why are we always talking only about foreign direct investment? What about local investment?
Of course, local investment comes first. That's why I said you have to first create the satisfaction, the sense of security with the local investors. Then this is going to be transmitted to the foreign investors. But of course, we have to start first with our domestic investors, 100%. But the idea is how, to answer your question, why people are not producing, because we don't have the equilibrium. It's very important to establish the equilibrium between four existing forces in Egypt. Whether we do like it or not, we have the present regime who is ruling the country. That's force number one. We have the 25th of January regime, the revolution regime, and I am proud to, I consider myself talking to them, who are not in power at the moment. And we have the Mubarak regime, which is still trying to go back now, and we can all feel it, with a lot of businessmen from the time of Mubarak coming back into the picture, and some of the ministers now from Mubarak regime are coming back. And of course, we have to admit that the Islamists, and I mean to say Islamists, not Muslims, Islamists, those who pretend to be religious, are still there. So how can we compromise all these forces together and get them together so that we have a strong, stable, this is our country, whether we like it or not. Whether we do like it or not, this is our country. We have to reconcile together.
Reconcile these, with no political exclusion, which is
exactly,
the pinnacle of democracy.
Exactly, that's the point. And then you will create stability and then people will start producing. It's very important to realize this.
On this very optimistic note, Dr. Amr Hamid, professor of economics at one of the prominent universities here in Egypt, thank you very much, and you have a very good day.
It's my pleasure. Same to you.
Thank you very much, sir, for coming.
Thank you.
And dear viewers, now we go for this short break, and we'll be right back.